Go get it. Okay, you stay. Stay. Hello. Yeah. Oh, John. Good. I'm doing really well. I've had my second treatment. I'm feeling great.
The expression doing really well is more than just idle conversation for Marcia Weedman of Poulsbo, Washington. She suffers from ovarian cancer. For 2 years now, she's battled a disease that more often than not takes no prisoners.
I was just kind of figuring, well, now how long is it going to take me to die? That's where I was. I mean, I had even told my employer it's time for you to get me replaced because I'm going downhill and I was getting sick fast. And so I already told my employer it was time to replace me. Well, once I don't have a job, I might as well quit because that's my life.
But this nurse didn't quit. Instead, as she tells Phil producer Jessica Martin, something just short of a miracle happened.
2 days after I told my boss that, 2 days after that, we found out about this Taxol thing. Well, I mean, then there's this little glimmer of hope. And then when I got in the program, I mean, it's a great, huge glimmer of hope. For example, the tumor on this side was, I think it was 19 by 23 centimeters. And now it's only like 15 by 13 or something like that. So it shrunk probably 2 inches. And then I had another small palpable tumor up here on this right side. He can't even feel now. It's gone. He can't feel it. And a small one in my pelvis that's shrunk significantly. And that's all just in 3 weeks. So now we're not looking for anybody to replace me again. I'm doing my job. It's wonderful.
Marcia's glimmer of hope sprang from something that used to end up in logging slash piles, the yew tree. From this tree, scientists have unlocked the secret to the newest, most important cancer-fighting drug in 15 years. That drug is Taxol. Dr. Joanna Kane of the University of Washington Medical Center explains that Taxol stops cancer cells by inhibiting cell division, a very different method from past chemotherapy.
For us, the main positive is that it causes responses in people for whom we have nothing else. The main long-term positive is that potentially we won't have people who need chemotherapy beyond the first round if we can cure them the first time through. And we're very hesitant to talk about cure in that sort of disease. But it seems like this may be an opportunity.
So it appears we've been provided a weapon against one of the greatest scourges on Earth. A tree once revered for making longbows and lutes now shows promise not only in the fight against ovarian cancer, but others like breast, colon, and lung. But there's a catch. It can take up to 10 of these trees to treat one patient. And while that sounds like a small price to pay for a human life, such a demand could wipe out the very source of the drug. If we cut down every yew tree today, there wouldn't be enough Taxol to treat even a fraction of the world's cancer patients tomorrow. Taxol comes from the thin, fragile bark of the Pacific yew, a rather gangly, shade-loving variety of yew that exists only in this region of the world. Relatively few in numbers, this oldest of trees still surviving in our ancient forest grows at a very leisurely pace, as slow as 1 inch every 50 years. Forester Nancy Lankford.
Well, this tree is about 16 inches or so in diameter, and in looking at the stand and the overstoring at this tree, it's probably 200, 250 years old or so. And
this is everyone agrees that this species is now of utmost importance. The real controversy seems to center on just how well the trees are being managed.
We're here. This is a typical clear cut. This happened this summer on the Umpqua National Forest, and I don't care what the Forest Service says, they are wasting this resource. They've left hundreds and hundreds of pounds on this sale alone. I mean, there is enough yew bark here to potentially save the lives of at least dozens of cancer patients.
We have found that sort of waste virtually everywhere we have looked. The Pacific yew may be the most valuable tree in the forest, and yet the natural resources agencies, the Bureau of Land Management and the Forest Dust Service, are managing this program from the seat of their pants.
Charges of waste and mismanagement, theft and monopolization of the yew have come from people like Congressman Ron Wyden and Wendell Wood of the Oregon Natural Resources Council. They feel the waste began when the National Cancer Institute, after years of experimentation that proved Taxol to be an extremely valuable drug, took bids from pharmaceutical companies to manufacture it. Bristol-Myers Squibb won out. They now have first rights to all the Pacific yew bark left in the world, a move Commissioner Jerry Rust of Eugene feels was a major mistake.
This monopoly is holding down the development of and production of Taxol in this country. I'm convinced of that, absolutely.
This is the first instance I know of where one company is literally transferred control over a species. And I'm particularly concerned because if you write an open-ended contract between the federal government, the natural resources agencies, and a major drug company, and the federal government commits to specifics, such as 750,000 pounds of bark a year, and the drug company commits to virtually nothing other than what it chooses in its own discretion to do, it's an invitation to this kind of waste and mismanagement.
Coordination.
But John Lowe, Deputy Chief Forester of Region 6, believes they've done everything they can to take control of an unprecedented situation.
Our highest commitment is to maintain the viability of the yew species. It was an attempt to take a very limited supply of raw material and make sure it got in the right places to get at the answers that everyone's trying to reach right now.
The area we're in right here is next to a timber sale unit where they harvested the timber for other species. And then this summer we've allowed yew bark peelers to come in and to peel the bark. And what the peelers do is they score the bark right at the stump, and they leave a stump that's with the bark intact that's large enough to re-sprout.
While no one wants to deny patients life-saving medicine, some feel the current method of getting Taxol is a short-sighted, quick fix.
Let's put it this way. These are 200, 300-year-old trees. We do not know how many of them there are. We do know they're quite rare. They have yet to replant one single tree in our forests. So we're cutting 200 and 300 year old trees down. It can't be sustainable.
Some of the older trees that we're taking out, it will take a while before they get back to that size and age. But I think the accusation that there's mismanagement in terms of mining out the species or whatever is really not accurate.
This Pacific yew was cut 2 years ago, possibly 3 years ago, and as you can see, it really is a prolific sprouter. Some of these sprouts are several feet high and they're quite abundant, so it's just a dramatic example of what the tree can do when the bark is left on the stump.
But look at the stump. You got little trees. Here's your next growth. But when they burn this, it's going to be wiped out.
We know that in some cases we've broadcast burned around stumps and they have sprouted back. We know in some cases we've broadcast around stumps and they didn't sprout back.
Bristol-Myers Squibb contracted with Hauser Chemical Research Incorporated and its subsidiary, Hauser Northwest Incorporated, to take the bark. Mike Trumbull, as manager of Hauser Northwest, handles the harvest.
We took the bark off of the limbs out to a 1-inch diameter and took the bark off the tops and then left the log and the rest of the tree for the Forest Service to market to specialty product people.
This was just cut just this last year. It's a perfectly good bark. Specific yew right here. I've just pulled off here right now. There's about 2 pounds of bark right there.
But Hauser says they never had anything to do with this stand. They claim its yew was taken by another party in the summer of 1990, before the harvesting was as regulated. They assume they will come back to stands like these this harvesting season and collect anything that was left behind. The Forest Service says they will hold off broadcast burning until that's accomplished. But there may be another reason bark has been found in slash piles.
After a certain period of time, mold and some other growth that it may have will, it does get in a condition where it's not usable. A lot of the units that we've had in logging, I think, where people are accusing that we're leaving bark in, was units that's been cut several years ago.
While Bristol-Myers Squibb pays for inventory and research on the yew, but not for the bark itself, There is speculation that others, perhaps overseas, are paying heavily for the Northwest new cash crop. The monopoly has borne a black market, and poaching is now a problem.
There is obvious waste here. There are trees that were just stripped as high as a person could reach.
In the fall of 91, in a federal sting operation, one of Hauser's own agents was arrested for buying stolen yew. Hauser could not comment on that case at this time. Next year, the National Cancer Institute wants even more bark for experimentation.
Now, I don't think we should just go strip the world bare of yew trees, but we can grow yew trees again. You know, and when people die, they don't grow again.
Companies like Weyerhaeuser are trying to grow yews in nurseries, but it looks like trees aren't the long-term answer.
We really need completely synthetic forms mm-hmm. to make a difference.
The NCI hopes to be free of its dependence on wild yews by 1998. And in fact, one researcher has already produced a semi-synthetic version of Taxol. But while synthetics may be the future, there's another alternative that many feel would have a more immediate, positive impact on the situation.
You have the potential for getting about as much Taxol out of a tree if you utilize the needles as you do if you just get the bark. And the good thing about needles is it's renewable. You can crop it again and again, like an apple tree. You wouldn't cut an apple tree down to get your apples.
Are you harvesting needles?
We have not harvested needles. We've looked into the needle process along with a lot of others. It has approximately 10% Taxol compared to the bark, so it would be 10 times as costly to manufacture.
Still, the Seattle Times reported that a company called Napro has plans to pursue this method and become Bristol-Myers Squibb's first competition. But this form of Taxol is more complicated to extract and could be years away from FDA approval.
Well, people are dying off. The bureaucracy is just dawdling, and that's how the bureaucracy works. But I mean, I think it's inexcusable.
But until new sources of Taxol are available, will the yew survive its call to duty?
I understand the environmentalist side, and I understand the timber side, and I'm a native of this state. But that's not the same world as living and dying.
T.S. Eliot wrote, "Redeem the time, redeem the dream. Till the wind shake a thousand whispers from the yew." The wind has shaken, and the yew has whispered hope and mercy, and the dream of health has been redeemed.
It is absolutely incredible to me that something out of a bark can give you a shot to live like this. That's great.